Hello everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus, the video podcast series where we take a few episodes and deep dive into one topic. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and boy, it's been a long time since we posted one of these. So thank you so much for joining us. I'm excited to be here. I hope you are too. Now, because the show is coming back from the dead, so to speak, and we are approaching Halloween, we thought it would be fun to start with everyone's favorite undead bedsheet apparition, ghosts. So over the next three episodes, we'll be talking about what science says about ghosts. We're going to myth bust about hauntings, get into what we actually know about what happens when we die, what we don't know about what happens when we die, and then we'll get into the pros and cons of believing in ghosts. This is just the first episode, so make sure you're subscribed to the channel. You get that nice, fun little alert when the next two episodes come out. And if you don't, I'll haunt you. You know, metaphorically speaking. Okay, so let's get into it. Ghosts. Have you seen one? No, I mean, like, really, have you? It's okay to say, yeah, I think I've seen a ghost. You have a lot of company. Plenty of people have ghost stories. A recent YouGov poll found that 20% of Americans believe in ghosts, saying they definitely exist, and another 25% said that they probably exist. So it's about half the country that says that ghosts probably exist. And of course, it's not just limited to the USA. The idea of ghosts can be found in one form or another in just about every culture, in every part of the world, in all of recorded history. So why? Why do we see or hear ghosts? Or at least, why do we think we see or hear ghosts? Well, the first thing we should go over is a concept that many of you are probably familiar with, pareidolia. This is the phenomenon where your brain takes something random and gives it meaning. You can think of craters on the moon that we see a face in, or random shapes of a cloud that we interpret to look like a bunny, or when we see some shadows cast on a wall, and ah! It's a ghost! This is one of the go-to scientific explanations for why people see ghosts. Numerous studies state that the more people see faces in objects, the more they probably believe in paranormal things. And according to science, when you combine our tendency to see patterns where there are none with an existing belief in the supernatural, the likelihood that you'll see something goes up. There's actually been studies on this, on how belief in ghosts or the paranormal will make you more likely to see a ghost. One study showed that if there's a credible source that says ghosts are real, the likelihood that people will believe in them goes up. The study pointed out that children and scientists were counted as credible sources, but written text was not, so do with that what you will. Other studies have shown that if you verbally tell someone something like, hey, this place is haunted, before you go in, you're more likely to think you see a ghost once you're inside. One study mentioned the White Christmas effect, where they asked participants to close their eyes and think of that song for 30 seconds. You can go ahead and do it right now. You know the one, right? I'm dreaming. Okay, I'm gonna stop singing it, but just listen. Do you think you actually started hearing it? Because most participants in this study said that they could hear the song clearly. Scientists have connected this to hauntings, saying if you're in a dark old building that someone told you is haunted, and you close your eyes and listen for voices or chains rattling or spooky sounds, you might just be tricked into hearing it. The paper I read also pointed out that studies into why people see ghosts are mostly inconclusive, because if you believe, it's more likely you're going to see it no matter what, and if you're skeptical, you're more likely not to see it. So because of that, the data is kind of skewed and difficult to parse. But psychologically, if you believe there is a ghost, your brain is more likely to create something out of nothing. Also, it's good to note that scientists have related ghost experiences with things like sleep deprivation, tiredness, drug use, brain disorders, and epilepsy. I'm going to skip all of those because I didn't actually find a lot of studies on those. They are usually used in throwaway lines and opening paragraphs of articles or studies about why we see ghosts, but I do want to read one opening paragraph of a paper called Sensory Dynamics of Visual Hallucinations in the Normal Population. Quote, Hallucinations can occur in both healthy and unwell people. Drugs, sleep deprivation, loss of vision, and migraines can all trigger visual hallucinations in people with no psychiatric illness. We have known for more than 200 years that flickering light can induce hallucinations in almost anyone. Unquote. We knew that for 200 years? Who knew that? I didn't know that. Okay, sorry. I got carried away because I'm just a little surprised they just dropped that in there like everybody knew. But looking into this, what they really are saying is they can make people see gray blobs with flashing light, which, you know, big whoop. Call me when you can make people see a floating pirate ship or something. Anyway, let's get into some explanations for ghost sightings that kind of fascinate me when I learned about them. My personal favorite theory is carbon monoxide poisoning. There's a famous case of a family that moved into a big old house and they started experiencing classic haunting things. You know, strange sensations, hearing footsteps, seeing figures. All of these symptoms were traced back to a faulty furnace that was leaking carbon monoxide. There's a more recent case where a woman was in a panic after seeing a ghost while taking a shower, which I think I'd panic if I saw anybody while taking a shower. When they investigated it, a new gas water heater was found to be installed improperly and it was filling her house with carbon monoxide. The interesting thing I think about the carbon monoxide explanation is carbon monoxide poisoning lines up with a lot of things that are often attributed to hauntings. Things like pressure in your chest, auditory hallucinations, and, my personal favorite, a feeling of unexplained dread. So add to that fact that carbon monoxide is made when heating appliances like stoves and furnaces aren't well maintained, which is more likely to happen in aging, dilapidated buildings, and it's easy to see how many creaky old houses get a reputation for being haunted. Though, again, carbon monoxide leaks, they can happen anywhere. One woman in a suburb of LA called Sherman Oaks was sure she was haunted until she learned about carbon monoxide poisoning, had the gas company come out and test for it, and yeah, they found it was there. They even told her that if she hadn't called, she probably would have died soon. And I just want to say, I've been to Sherman Oaks. I live near Sherman Oaks. There's no ghosts in Sherman Oaks, so I'm glad she called the gas company. Another fun explanation for hauntings that is definitely not ghosts is actually sound waves. One study cited in a paper I was reading called The Physics of False Poltergeists, which is just a fantastic paper name. Anyway, the author's basic point was some natural acoustic phenomena can do things like rattle windows and doors and create some noise illusions. There's also evidence that infrasound, sound below the range that you can hear, which is at about 19 hertz, can cause you to have these eerie feelings and a sense of doom. It can also cause vibrations in your eyeball that make you perceive seeing things out of the corner of your eye. This happened to one guy in a lab, and he wrote a paper about it called Ghost in the Machine, which, again, another great paper title. Basically, he found a fan that was running and was emitting this low-frequency sound, and when he turned it off, his paranormal experiences stopped. Now, not everyone agrees with the Ghost in the Machine conclusion that there is a fear frequency, so to speak, that exists. However, there have been a lot of tests and studies into infrasound and sound waves, and it feels like there's a definite connection between infrasound and this sense of uneasiness. So I actually went into this episode thinking that we were going to completely blow the lid off all of these hauntings, but it's funny how often science looks into finding actual reasons for paranormal stuff and still a lot of times walks away going, eh, who knows? Again, the challenge is getting unbiased data, and also it's really tough to prove that something doesn't exist. Finally, let's talk about sleep paralysis, which many experts point to as why people report ghosts and, as a bonus, alien abductions. So basically, when you're dreaming in REM sleep, your body tries to be in a paralysis mode. So if you're dreaming about running, jumping, baking a cake with Celine Dion, whatever it may be, your body doesn't actually act those things out. Now, sometimes things get screwed up and you start to wake up, but your body is still in this state of paralysis. Now, because things are screwed up, you also might have a kind of waking dream. These hallucinations, they can be visual, but they can also be sound or smell or a feeling. An interview with a doctor at the Cleveland Clinic said that the contents of these hallucinations kind of come down to your culture. Again, if you grew up thinking that there are paranormal things and you wake up paralyzed and hallucinating, your mind is probably going to go to something paranormal, like ghosts or demons. Sleep paralysis and sleep hallucinations are two different things, but they can occur together. There's a great Boston Globe article breaking down how this is all caused by brain communication getting its wires crossed, and if you're interested, you should read it. It's fascinating stuff. We'll put it in the show notes. Okay, so after all that, where do I land? Do I believe in ghosts, or has science convinced me they don't exist? Well, I think that there are so many things out there that can mess with us, starting first and foremost with our brain. Our brain is not the reliable, objective observer that we would all like to believe it is, which I think can account for a lot of hauntings. There's also been some great research done on ghosts and hauntings. Most try to find explanations for what people have experienced. But the trouble is, every situation is different. Different places, different people, it's hard to replicate something consistently like this and really study it. You can't make a haunted house in a lab and test it over and over again. At least, you know, not ethically. You can't make a haunted house ethically. Don't do a murder in a lab for the sake of science. Plus, you know, what part of it do you study? Do you study the feeling of there being a ghost present, or the actual sightings, or the sounds people hear, or doors closing, or furniture's moving? There's so much that happens that people attribute to ghosts. An article on Live Science put it perfectly. If they exist, scientists will be able to prove it. So far, they haven't. And I've provided a lot of studies that offer really compelling alternative explanations. So maybe to understand if ghosts really exist, we have to study what happens when we die. Because after all, ghosts are often thought to be the wayward spirits of the dead. So then, what do we know about what happens when we die? We'll get to all that on the next episode of Seeker Plus. Hey, thanks for watching. Thank you for tuning in for our return episode. Be sure that you're subscribed so you get notifications when the future episodes in this series on ghosts come out and when future series come out as well. If you've got any ideas for where the show should go, what topics we should cover, be sure to leave those in the comments. It can be about anything you want. It can be about bears or hares, squares, county fairs. Doesn't have to rhyme with bears. Really anything, just leave it in the comments. Thanks again for watching. See you next time.